Last summer, I had an opportunity to go up to the Pittsburgh area for a meeting on behalf of Bishop. And I got out in the airport, got out to a cab. I was going to St. Vincent's in Latrobe. Got out to a cab, got in the cab, and, you know, like my brother priests, I was all dressed in clerical attire. And so the cabbie says to me, "So you're a Catholic priest?" And I said, "Yes, sir, I am." And so he said, "So you believe in Jesus?" And I said, "Yes, sir, I do. He's our Savior, and he's the founder of our church." He said, "So you believe that Jesus is going to come again?" And I said, "Yes, sir, I do. And if you don't slow down, maybe he's going to come sooner than I'd like." But then the cabbie had a key question, and it was this: When is our Lord coming? That's a perennial question that so many people ask. When? And it's obviously not a new question, right? Because people in the time of our Lord were also asking it. When? And so not only when in terms of our death, but when he will come to judge the living and the dead at the end of time. And so to that question, when, Jesus says, "I don't know. I don't know." Jesus, in his human side, says, "I don't know." And he also says, "Even the angels don't know. Only my Father in heaven knows the day and the hour." The point? Well, for us, everybody, some great Catholic wisdom that is universal for us in the church throughout the world. As Catholics, you and I, fundamentally, we don't worry about when, because you and I, as Catholics, take our Lord at his word, because he doesn't even know himself. And so what do? As Catholics, you and I are invited to pay attention to being prepared at the moment of our death and for the end of time. Now, you and I know that there are plenty of folks around, even in Jesus' time, but we've probably run into a whole bunch of them that like to point to this sign or that one. Like even in the gospel, talking about all those cataclysmic things that could happen in nature. We think about and pray for in solidarity for all the people who are suffering from all those fires in California. Have you heard about that? Incredible, the amount of people that are missing. I think over 1,200 people are missing. But we think about people down where Deacon Rick Fisher's from in New Bern, people down where Monsignor Natua is from and where Father Milanda is from, down in the Wilmington area, who have suffered such terrible damage from the effects of the amount of water that came in with Hurricane Florence. We think about all those kind of things, and many of you know from your home country many things that people have had to endure. And people may look at that and perhaps say, "There it is, there is a sign. Their Lord's return is near." But you know what, for us as Catholics, we've learned after 2,000 years of history, that while those may indeed be signs, we don't worry about it. We don't waste our time trying to figure it out. Instead, as Catholics, we're like the United States Coast Guard. They have a motto. I don't know if you remember the motto of the Coast Guard. Semper paratus. I'm not going to give you a Latin quiz today, okay? So don't worry. Semper paratus. Always be ready. Always be prepared. That's, in a way, everybody, part of the mission of our church. Holy Mother Church, whether in the United States, whether in the Congo, whether in Nigeria, whether in Uganda, whether in the Ivory Coast, whether here in the United States, anywhere in the world, it is Holy Mother Church's mission to help us to be prepared. And so, however much you and I, we might enjoy and relish and appreciate the tremendous joys and beauty and blessings of life in this world as we know it, for us, and I'm going to use a little Italian word, for us, this world is just a little antipasto. It's a little appetizer. It's a little warm up for, I don't know if they have it, Father Pius, maybe some goat. It's a little warm up for the big meal. It's a little warm up for what our Lord tells us about. Do you remember in the Gospel of St. John the Evangelist? Jesus says to us, I go before you to prepare a place for you, so that where I am, you also may be. It is that hope which we celebrate in and through our Catholic faith, in and through Holy Mother Church, in and through the sacraments, in and through the works of charity and justice, in and through the works of sacred liturgy that we prepare. And how beautifully we see it here on display every year when we have the African Ancestry Mass. St. Paul writes about the Lord loves a cheerful giver. Now, us as not those who are not necessarily from the home countries of Africa, we've never witnessed this, but when you come up in the offertory, oh my Lord, are you ever cheerful? I've never seen anything like that. You literally dance up the aisle. I think that's absolutely fabulous. We sang the Kyrie, Lord have mercy, Christ have mercy, Lord have mercy. We were doing that one year, and a priest who was joining us that year said, Monsignor, what are they singing? And I said, I don't know. He says, I don't know either, but it sounds joyful. That sense of joy, that sense of hope that is given to us in faith in Jesus Christ, it all helps us to be pointed in hope to the Lord. It helps us to prepare. More to it now. Remember what our Lord said. In those days the sun will be darkened, and the moon will not give his light, and the stars will be falling from the sky. The sun, the moon, the stars. What are those things? What could that possibly mean? Well, think about it in terms of the mind of the person who lived in the first century, who our Lord was speaking to. What are those things? Well, if you lived in the first century, you would know that the sun, the moon, and the stars especially, they were like the GPS of the first century, the Waze app, maybe you use that app on your phone to get where you need to go. These were places, these were things in nature that helped them to navigate their way, to help them to get where they were going. So Jesus said, all of that will be darkened. It'll fail us. What's that mean? Well, on one level, of course, everybody, what is our Lord talking about? But his own passion and death that we see so beautifully captured each and every time we look at a blessed crucifix, his passion and death. Because our Lord knew that for everybody who loves him, that would be as if the sun was darkened. The moon was no longer shedding its light, and the stars were falling for all those people who loved him. But here it is on another level. It's also about when death happens in our own experience to a dear family member, a dear friend. When that happens, and in a special way, I think, for many of you, when that happens, and especially back in your home country, it is as if the sun is darkened, and the moon is no longer giving its light, and the stars are falling. In other words, in that person who has died, the person who perhaps as a parent, as a dear family member, as a close friend, they were a person who helped you to navigate life. They were a person who perhaps encouraged you to come and make an opportunity, a new one for your family here in the United States. And now they're gone. It's as if all the ways in which you've been able to navigate are suddenly deeply disturbed. Jesus knew the experience of death like that and what it can cause in the hearts of each of us. But he also knew, our Lord did, our Lord knew what his Father, God the Father, would do with that experience of death. And so over and over again, everybody, what does our Lord say to us in sacred scripture? He says, I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, though he should die, will come to life. And whoever is alive and believes in me will never die. Growing up, I was always kind of envious of my two older sisters because they got to know all of my grandparents. By the time I was born, all my grandparents were with the Lord, save one of them, my Grandma B, my dad's mom, Grandma Brockman. And I can remember, she lived down in South Carolina, just outside of Greenville, South Carolina. And I can remember spending a couple weeks with her one summer. My parents dropped me off there to be with her. And I remember helping her to clean the house. She gave me a job and in one room and she went off to another. But all of a sudden in that next room, I could hear that she was sobbing, her tears flowing from her eyes. And so I went to her and I saw her with what looked like a shirt covering her eyes. And she pulled it away from her as I approached her And she showed it to me. And she said, I found this jammed at the back of one of the drawers in the dresser. This, she said, was your grandfather's. She said, he's been gone now for over 30 years, and how I miss him still. But then she said this. She said, you know what, David? In the Lord, I know that I have not seen him for the last time. Semper paratus. Always be ready. And if right now, in your life, if the sun is darkened, if everything you've known is somehow disturbed, together with all the great saints and the holy souls of history, use that same gift that the Lord has given to you, that you sing of so joyfully and beautifully and reverently. Draw upon that gift. And as you come forward in just a few moments to consume our Lord, who is the bread of life for us, allow him to consume you. Allow his life to come within your own. And in faith, be strengthened and say the words, Amen. Yes, Lord, I believe.